in the mood on a roll.
You want the police to come?
You are currently traveling in an area where guidance cannot be provided.
Okay, so y'all blocking the road.
Straight line distance information to proceed to the highway.
So you're blocking the road and I can't leave.
I record things because of situations just like this.
No, sir, we're not blocking the road. You can't leave.
Eric Eccles used his cell phone to record this explosive encounter with Sandra Lamb as he delivered a subpoena last July.
Private investigator in the Tanya Kraft case is speaking out about the investigation. Eric Eccles was hired by Kraft's defense. Eccles claims Coatoosa County authorities told him to stop interviewing witnesses.
...into the arrest of that private investigator working for Tanya Kraft's defense team. Eric Eccles is charged with threatening one of the accusers and her parents.
Lamb filed a criminal warrant accusing Eccles of harassment. He went to court for what he thought would be a magistrate hearing, but became suspicious when Lamb walked in without an attorney.
She didn't do anything without an attorney, and when she showed up without one, that's when I knew something was not right.
Could you wait a moment? I looked over to my attorney and I said, something's getting ready to happen. At that time, they cleared the courtroom. I had to wait. I saw Detective Bill walk in. I saw two other sheriffs walk in. I looked at my attorney. I said, okay, something's going on. They walked over to me and arrested me.
Prosecutor Chris Arndt had a three-count indictment against Eccles. The charges, influencing a witness.
Was stated in the conversation, people are going to be just as equally surprised that I even was arrested.
Now a new book brings us a first-person account of the troubles Kraft and her team faced while trying to prove her innocence. And Eric Eccles, the private investigator for the Kraft team, is joining us this morning. Good morning to you, Eric.
Good morning.
Glad to have you here.
Good. It's good to be here.
Now, you've written the new book about the case. What actually went into this? What prompted you to turn your investigations and the Tanya Kraft case into a story?
Well, the book was written about just to show people some of the things that I've investigated and going into the case that led up into my arrest. And, you know, one of the reasons why I wrote the book was to show people that injustice still occurs in small towns. And then the other part is why I wrote the book was to just to let people know that, you know, enough is enough. When you have so much injustice that's going on in one community and one justice system like Coatoosa County, the only way to expose it is to talk about it. And this was a good time for the book to come out with the elections and things of that nature. So I just want people to realize that, you know, those type of things still happen in Coatoosa.
Now, you were working for Tanya Kraft and for her defense team doing private investigation, trying to provide some background, some evidence to prove her innocence. What was it that led authorities to actually arrest you in this case?
Well, part of my role was to do interviews, track down witnesses, interview witnesses, do background researches on the key players, the whole nine yards. And one of the interviews of the alleged victim's parents, the father, we had a nice two-hour interview. And in that interview, there were some things that were stated that the DA didn't want to get out. He told me that he never thought Tanya was molested his daughter. He told me that he was being forced into the interview or enforced in the case against Tanya Kraft. So he told me some real things that I believed that was truthful. And based on that interview, the district attorney turned around and had me indicted on three felony counts of witness tampering. Now keep in mind, I only talked to the one individual, but I was indicted on three counts because in the conversation, his wife was mentioned and the alleged victim's child was mentioned. So I actually got charged for two people I didn't even talk to.
Do you think they were just trying to intimidate you, or were they trying to actually influence this case?
No, I think it was a little of both. I think they wanted to shut me down. Chris Arndt, the chief district attorney over there, he knew that I was on to some good information. He didn't want me messing up his case against Tanya. So the best way to shut me down was to arrest me. So I think it was both parts. They wanted to do that, and they wanted to influence the jury pool.
Now, you've been a private investigator for many, many years, operating in Catoosa County on this case. What kind of lessons did you learn?
Well, operating on this case, I wrote in the book, as like a training tool. I mean, you have to always cover yourself. I think had I not recorded the conversation with Jerry McDonald, things would have probably ended up differently for me, because it would have been my word against Catoosa County.
Sure.
And because I had those recordings, then everybody knew that, wait a minute, he didn't influence or threaten anybody. I think that's why the judges, all four judges, recused themselves from the case. That's why the indictment was quashed. And that's why later the district attorney came back and said, well, wait a minute, we're not going to proceed with this case for a lack of evidence.
You know, a lot of folks in the Tennessee Valley followed the Tanya Craft case back in 2010 when it was brought to trial. Obviously, there's some revealing information in the book. What do you think people are going to find most fascinating, or something that they're going to be like, wow, I had no idea that was going on?
Well, I think they're going to find a lot of things. I was speaking to a friend yesterday, and she told me when she read the book, she laughed, she cried, she got upset, and she said, oh, my God, this still happens today. So I think what's going to happen, people are going to really realize, is that, you know, these things still occur. A person can be slapped in the face, assaulted on video, and called a racial slur and get away with it. A person can be, you know, handcuffed in the court of law when trying to file charges for assault, you know, because they're connected in that county. And when you're connected in that county, that just puts a damper on the entire justice system. And, you know, somebody like myself, who grew up always believing in the justice system, now believes that the justice system is now just a barter tool. It's something that can be traded based on who you know, based on your social economics, based on your influence with people within the justice system. And people outside need to say, well, wait a minute, that's not right. Fair game of any place should happen in the court of law.
So how do we change that?
Well, you expose it. You talk about it, you support, you read the book, you do those type of things. One of the things that I'm doing with the book to help expose it is to start an investigative fund where people who need adequate investigation can't afford it. Hopefully, you know, the proceeds from the book can support that and say, wait a minute, let me look into that case, because now I'm licensed in Tennessee as well as a private investigator. So now I can come to Tennessee and do cases. I'm licensed in North Carolina. So these are the type of things that will expose that injustice, is the people to support, you know, what was going on.
The book is called The Eccles Files, Catoosa County Justice. It's available at Amazon and Barnes & Noble in paperback. You can also download it digitally on Amazon for the Kindle. It is out right now.
This piece of paper brings Cobb County-based private eye Eric Eccles the news he's longed for. The felony counts he faced in connection with the Tanya Craft child molestation case have been quashed.
Count number 22, not guilty.
Craft was acquitted earlier this year of all charges, but Eccles still faced three counts he intimidated witnesses. Eccles and other private eyes feared if his charges had gone through, it would have had a chilling effect on private investigations nationwide. After all, Eccles could have been sent to prison, and even now, still has a $15,000 legal bill.
If being a private investigator means you won't take certain type of cases because of fear that someone can falsely arrest you, then I wouldn't be a private investigator.